years ago, overuse of fertilizers that are not effectively taken up by the crop, not efficiently used, pollutes water bodies, and this is an example in China where a lot of fertilizers are used, probably too much fertilizer is used, causing environmental issues. Another cause of concern regarding environmental issues is that, like all land uses, the production of rice also has an impact on the climate. We know that rice is one of the substantial contributors to the emission of methane. So the bottom line of showing briefly these examples is that we think that increasing yield, grain quality and resource use efficiency are very much part of the solution to these problems. We also know that besides the resources becoming less available, the environment in which we're working is getting increasingly stressed, and climate change is contributing to this. We will face more droughts, more flooding, more salinity, more extreme temperatures. So resource use efficiency needs to be increased under these increasingly adverse conditions. We have, of course, a whole arsenal of research delivered response options that we are working on, that we have worked on, and that we need to work on in the future, ranging from management technologies. An example here is a management technology to help cope with irrigation water scarcity. We have variety technologies. Here is an example of the very successful discovery of the SUP1 gene that confirms tolerance to prolonged flooding in the field. And we have more ecological based solutions in the bottom at the landscape level, where we try to modify how the landscape looks like to increase its resilience and biocontrol functions again. So, coming now back to our strategic exercise, our methodology is first, we try to set out to identify, map and quantify these constraints to rice production, both in terms of the abiotic constraints such as drought and salinity, and biotic constraints, pests and diseases. We want to identify opportunities to increase yield, the quality of it, and the resource use efficiency, so the efficiency of fertilizers, of water with which we produce the yield, and to alleviate these constraints. And we want to identify then and analyze real farmer adoptable solutions. That's what we're talking about in this strategic exercise. So we are focusing on actual products that are research delivered and can be adopted by the farmers and realize some of these constraint alleviation, increased yield and reduced costs. This is our methodological framework, and it's a different look at what David presented. Potential yield is the highest yield. Potential yield means there are no biotic or abiotic constraints limiting yield. It's really the expression of the genetic potential of a certain variety in terms of ton per hectare. In practice, yield will be limited because there are constraints, unavailability of water, of fertilizers, and drought, etc. And then yield can be further reduced. It might be a limited yield that could be produced in practice, but when you have a swarm of brown plant hoppers coming in, that yield might be reduced. So, yield potential, a variety property mainly, grain quality, a variety property mainly, although we all know that there is G by E interaction, and like we discussed yesterday afternoon in this very same room, G by E by technology, by culture, by social, by political conditions. But we want to focus here on the variety characteristics. And implicit in realizing a high yield is the efficiency of the resources to do that. Water, nutrients, labor are the ones we focus on. The limiting yield are then the abiotic constraints. We are looking at droughts, salinity, flooding, extreme temperatures. And reducing yields are pest diseases, weeds. Pests include insects pests, but also rodents. And we may have to look into golden apple snail, into birds when we talk about Africa, etc. So these are then the main working groups that looked at these constraints and opportunities. So we have a working group, multidisciplinary working group on increased yield potential, mainly genetics and breeding, increasing the quality of rice, using resources, water, nutrients, labor more efficiently, specifically targeting these abiotic constraints and the biotic constraints. These working groups, multidisciplinary, use expert knowledge, knowledge that these people have gained by working in the field for so long, and that comes back to the question, at this stage, did you involve farmers in the process? Yes, in the sense that the people who are looking into this have a wide experience on the ground working with farmers and our stakeholders to develop solutions, but they are not explicitly asked at this stage, what do you think about the methodology or the data? We look at literature, all kinds of data, and try to involve external contacts as much as possible at this stage. But I have to say, at this stage, it is mainly an eerie internal process. Spatial units, Andy Nelson explained that we have basically divided Asia into 220 units, which is obviously much too much detail to go through each of these 220 units. So we basically have a bird's eye view of East Asia, of Southeast Asia and South Asia. And within them, we look at these new 8 rice ecologies that Andy explained. So these are 4 irrigated lowland ecologies, 4 rainfed-based ecologies and 1 upland ecology. We look at single cropping of rice, double, triple, and explicitly cropping of rice, non-rice crops. So we look at all these cropping systems, which we at IRI like to call rice-based, but I guess if you work at CIMIT, you could equally well call them maize-based or wheat-based. So that is what we are looking at here. Just to recall, these are then the spatial maps that we have available of these ecologies in South Asia, East Asia, and Southeast Asia. So I want to give you a flavor of the preliminary results, show you some of the numbers, but especially draw attention to how we went about getting these numbers in here. So first are just the spatial extent of some of the constraints. And it would be so nice if we just could pull out from internet or a GS lab the data that say, well, this is drought and how it affects rice, this is our spread of diseases in terms of hectares and damage, etc. These data simply do not exist. And even I think for a relatively big player in the rice world like IRI, it's beyond our capacity to get all these data sets complete. So this is what we had to work with. On the right, top right center is an example of spatial mapping of outbreaks of plant hoppers and associated spread of viral diseases. So we get reports where it happens. So we have these dots on the map. We know that there are outbreaks there. In some cases we even have area extent, but it's far from complete. Here on the left-hand side is water scarcity. Now there are dozens of global water scarcity maps out there, which are all kind of qualitative. They use some index of water scarcity, they relate the amount of water availability to the amount of people living in a basin or in a country. They talk about, like IMI's maps, economic water scarcity, fiscal water scarcity. But at least we have maps that geographically delineate the hotspot and give an indication of the severity of water availability. Then here is something that we did in-house. Andy explained that, or I guess demonstrated that, there are quite a number of climate data out there, and I think for temperature they are much more reliable than for prediction of rainfall. So what we did in-house, for example, is look at high temperatures, where they currently occur, where they are predicted to occur, overlay that with where currently rice is being grown, and looking even at the most sensitive crop stage. We know that high temperatures are damaging to rice when they occur around flowering. So here we have a very precise map where in the black circles you can see temperatures at flowering under current cropping patterns. So we have something, we have very patchy things, we have some global things like the water scarcity and some in-house more detailed work, specialized. So we take our ecology maps and we overlay that roughly so we get an idea of the aerial extent of some of these constraints. Then we need to put numbers to that. So knowing that northeast of Thailand falls in the economic water scarcity domain of the IMI map, what does that mean for rice production? What does that mean for irrigation water available to farmers who grow rice in that particular area? So here I give a very simple example of what our team of water scientists came up with regarding irrigation water scarcity. I give here the example of East Asia. So first what we see is that only 3 of the 8 ecologies have numbers in them. Irrigation water scarcity is not a relevant issue in rain-fed agriculture. Drought is, and we work on drought there. In most of the wet seasons, there is enough water, and again, irrigation water scarcity is not a big deal. So there are 3 ecologies here. It is in the main rice-irrigated wet season in East Asia. It's in the dry season of double irrigated crops, where there is an issue, and double irrigated with another rice crop, very intensive, but again, primarily in the dry season part of that cropping system only. So these are then numbers that come out of survey of literature, of data availability, water availability, water use efficiencies, etc., in surface irrigation systems of rice. And we basically see that in many systems in these areas, about 25% of the command area is fallowed in the dry season because of lack of water. Here in the wet season, that's estimated to be 15%. Beside area not irrigated, these are the numbers that we came up with. 15% of the irrigated area does not get enough water. So that experiences water scarcity. So the total area affected here is 40% and here it's 22%. Frequency of that, most of these systems were designed for supplementary irrigation in the wet season. They are now used for irrigation in the dry season. And basically that is a chronic state of affairs. So at least 1 in 2 years, 50% of the area will not be irrigated. In the area that suffers water scarcity, the 15% here, that results in about 30% yield loss. So that is how we try to go about it. There are technologies to alleviate this water scarcity and alleviate the impact on yield, but they won't be 100%. We won't be able to reduce the 30% yield loss to 0% yield loss. So the technologies that are adoptable by farmers, don't forget about, we talk about adoptable farmer technologies and their impact when they are adopted in the field, not when they are adopted at IRI's experimental research station. So we estimate that half of that yield loss can indeed be reduced. So how did we come up with these numbers? A lot of expert knowledge, a lot of literature data, practical experience of having worked in a few sites on that map. And one of the immediate concerns that all our scientists raised is that, oh, but I only worked 20 years in this field, and I worked mainly in China and in Indonesia and 3 sites in the Philippines. And I have very accurate data there. But how do you expect me to extrapolate that to all of Asia? And that's, I guess, one of the main challenges in our ambition to be comprehensive. we need to find mechanisms that allow a plausible extrapolation. And